Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. There is one body and one spirit. There is one hope to which we were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all. Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Friends, it is a great privilege to be with you this afternoon here in Buckingham. Thank you to Will and to everybody here who has put enormous effort into making this afternoon work in these rather strange COVID-safe conditions. Thanks to Quentin, our DDO, who has worked his socks off, really, in all sorts of ways for our ordinations this year. And thanks above all to our ordinands for your year of service, for all that that has meant to the communities that you serve. Thank you for your love of the Lord, and thank you for all the hope that you inspire in us as God leads you forward in ministry. Thank you so much. And I'm aware you've brought some friends and relations and others with you. For those who are just visiting or come to support someone in particular, thank you for your love and your prayers and for your welcome with us today. When it comes to communion, please take communion if that's something you usually do. There is a one-way system that we come up the middle and go down the sides, but I'm sure someone will show you the way when we get there. You are most welcome, and if you'd prefer just to have a blessing, please say. We're very happy to do that too. So we come to set people aside for God's service. God calls his people to follow Christ and forms us into a royal priesthood, a holy nation, to declare the wonderful deeds of him who has called us out of darkness into his own marvelous light. The church is the body of Christ, the people of God, and the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. In baptism, the whole church is summoned to witness to God's love and to work for the coming of his kingdom. To serve this royal priesthood, God has given particular ministries. Priests are ordained to lead God's people in the offering of praise and the proclamation of the gospel. They share with the bishop in the oversight of the church, delighting in its beauty and rejoicing in its well-being. They are always to set the example of the Good Shepherd before them as the pattern of their calling. With the bishop and their fellow presbyters, they are to sustain the community of the faithful by the ministry of word and sacrament, that we all may grow into the fullness of Christ and so be a living sacrifice acceptable to God.
Reverend Father in God, I present these persons to be ordained to the office of priest in the Church of God. James Richard Wesley Forward, to serve in the benefice of Gerard's Cross and Fulmer. Samson Olawale Olabodi Obafemi Kupani, to serve in the benefice of Burnham. Peter George Landry, to serve in the benefice of Bletchley. Gareth Lee Morley, to serve in the benefice of High Wycombe. Ross Andrew McGavin, to serve in the benefice of Buckingham.
Have those whose duty it is to know these deacons and to examine them found them to be of godly life and learning?
They have.
And do they believe them to be duly called to serve God in this ministry?
They do.
Friends, do you believe that God is calling you to this ministry?
I do so believe.
I'd invite the Archdeacon to confirm that these candidates have taken the necessary oaths and made the declaration of assent.
They have duly taken the oath of allegiance to the sovereign and the oath of canonical obedience to the bishop. They have affirmed and declared their belief in the faith which is revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic creeds, and to which the historic formularies of the Church of England bear witness.
Thank you, Chris. So let us pray. God our Father, Lord of all the world, through your Son, you have called us into the fellowship of your universal Church. Hear our prayer for your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry, each may be an instrument of your love. And give to your servants, now to be ordained, the needful gifts of your grace. Through our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. We sit to listen for God's word.
A reading from the book of Genesis. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day. He looked up and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent entrance to meet them and bowed down to the ground. He said, "My Lord, if I find favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought and wash your feet, and rest yourselves under the tree. Let me bring a little bread that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant." So they said, "Do as you have said." And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, "Make ready quickly 3 measures of choice flour, knead it, and make cakes." Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it before them, and he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, "Where is your wife Sarah?" And he said, "There, in the tent." Then one said, "I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son." And Sarah was listening at the tent entrance behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age. It had ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, "After I have grown old, and my husband is old, shall I have pleasure?" The Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old?' Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? At the set time, I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son." But Sarah denied, saying, "I did not laugh," for she was afraid. He said, "Oh yes, you did laugh." This is the word of the Lord.
As you are able, please stand to receive the gospel.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. When he entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, appealing to him and saying, "Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed in terrible distress." And he said to him, "I will come and cure him." The centurion answered, "Lord, I am not worthy to have you come under my roof, but only speak the word, and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man under authority, with soldiers under me, and I say to one, 'Go,' and he goes, and to another, 'Come,' and he comes, and to my slave, "Do this," and the slave does it. When Jesus heard him, he was amazed and said to those who followed him, "Truly, I tell you, in no one in Israel have I found such faith. I tell you, many will come from east and west and will eat with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven, while the heirs of the kingdom will be thrown into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." And to the centurion, Jesus said, "Go, let it be done for you according to your faith." And the servant was healed in that hour. When Jesus entered Peter's house, he saw his mother-in-law lying in bed with a fever. He touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she got up and began to serve him. That evening they brought to him many who were possessed by demons, and he cast out the spirits with a word and cured all who were sick. This was to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah. "He took our infirmities and bore our diseases." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please do sit down. Lord, take my words and speak through them. Take our thoughts and think through them. Take our hearts and set them on fire with love for you, through the power of the Holy Spirit, and in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Well, what a humbling experience and such a privilege to be invited to preach at this service this afternoon. When Bishop Allen asked me to preach today, I'm going to be honest, I must admit to feeling rather like Sarah in our reading from Genesis. Total disbelief. And I'm going to be honest with you again as well. I too laughed at the time, but I heard myself saying, "Yes, Bishop Allen, of course I will preach. Thank you so much for asking me." Well, here I am. This afternoon, I could speak to you about Sarah and Abraham's hospitality. I could talk to you about Jesus's compassion, healing the centurion's servant. But no, I believe our readings today are talking to us about depending on God, trusting God, not going it alone. Abraham has been through so much. He's wandered through the land, he's relocated his family, and together with Sarah, he's now waiting for God to fulfill the promise to give them a son. Throughout everything, Abraham has shown himself to be faithful. Well, most of the time. He certainly does trust God, even if his fears and doubts get the best of him, like they do sometimes. In our reading from Matthew, the centurion has no doubt that Jesus can and will cure his servant, even by a word, without needing to come to the house. He trusts God. You probably sat there thinking, trusting God. Now that can sound really flippant, but it certainly is not. I don't know about you, but I certainly like to hear a story. I'm sure you do as well. And Jesus told numerous stories. So I'm going to share with you a true story. A time when I had to place my trust in God because I was out of my depth. So here we go. I have volunteered as a hospital chaplain for a few years. And a few days before I was priested, I received a phone call from the hospital asking if I could get there as quickly as possible. A young mum had died earlier in the day, and the family were not accepting that she had died, and they would not let her body be moved. Everyone there was at a loss to know what to do, how they could help that family. So as I was driving along to the hospital, I prayed, God, please help me find the right words to assist the family in coming to terms with the death of their relative. I got to the ward and I was taken to the family. What I'd not anticipated was there was going to be so many relatives there. There was at least a dozen in this small, tiny room, most of them male, most of them way taller and bigger than me. I suddenly heard myself saying, actually introducing myself, and then I said, I'm unable to find any words that will comfort you at this time, but what I can do is pray. So let us pray. I can't remember what I prayed, but I can remember when I said, Amen. Every relative responded. A cousin then turned to me and asked, What happens now? What happens now Helen, not her real name, has died? What happens? What do we do? Within a few minutes, God had achieved what everyone else couldn't do. They'd been trying for hours. Trust God. We don't need to go alone. God gives us the words we need. He surrounds us with people who give us support and give us knowledge to deal with the situations we find ourselves in. So Kate, Ross, Gareth, Peter, Samson, James, shortly you'll be standing in front of Bishop Allen as he reads the ordination declarations, and you will receive the authority to stand at the altar and consecrate the bread and the wine. Stephen Cotterill, in his book on priesthood, he writes, It will be around God's table at the Eucharist that anyone who is called to the priesthood will find themselves most keenly aware of the immensity of this calling. Perhaps today, perhaps in the future, you may be asking yourselves, Can I fulfill God's call on my life? I believe that we all sometimes feel inadequate, and in my personal experience, that's not necessarily a bad thing for a priest, because it encourages us to remind ourselves of grounding everything we are called to do in prayer and to call upon God. None of us who hear God's calling on our lives, in whatever way that may turn out to be, can do it alone. We need to remember to call upon the Holy Spirit and have trust that God will provide. Nothing is impossible for God. Nothing is too hard for God. We're reminded of this when the Lord said to Abraham, Why did Sarah laugh and say, Will I really have a child now that I am old? Is anything too hard for the Lord? And he responds, I will return to you at the appointed time next year, and Sarah will have a son. Is anything too hard for the Lord? Well, the answer is obviously, of course not. Perhaps the next time you are struggling, when you're feeling inadequate, yes, even when you're writing a sermon for the ordination of priests and it's not flowing, stop and ask, is this too hard for the Lord? Asking this question is a way of reminding ourselves that God is personally involved in our life. And it also nudges us to ask for his power to help us. Remember, we don't and shouldn't ever go it alone. Amen.
Thank you so much, Nadine, for putting what we're doing in its real perspective within the love and in the kingdom of God. Can I invite ordinands, please, to stand? Priests are called to be servants and shepherds among the people to whom they are sent. With their bishop and fellow ministers, they are to proclaim the word of the Lord and to watch for the signs of God's new creation. They are to be messengers, watchmen and stewards of the Lord. They are to teach and to admonish, to feed and provide for his family, to search for his children in the wilderness of this world's temptations, and to guide them through its confusions, that they may be saved through Christ forever. Formed by the word, they are to call their hearers to repentance and to declare in Christ's name the absolution and forgiveness of their sins. With all God's people, they are to tell the story of God's love. They are to baptize new disciples in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and to walk with them in the way of Christ, nurturing them in the faith. They are to unfold the scriptures, to preach the word in season and out of season, and to declare the mighty acts of God. They are to preside at the Lord's table and lead his people in worship, offering with them a spiritual sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. They are to bless the people in God's name. They are to resist evil, to support the weak, to defend the poor, and to intercede for all in need. They are to minister to the sick and to prepare the dying for their death. Guided by the Spirit, they are to discern and foster the gifts of all God's people, that the whole church may be built up in unity and in faith. We trust that long ago you began to weigh and to ponder all this, and that now you are fully determined by the grace of God to devote yourselves wholly to his service, so that as you daily follow the rule and teaching of our Lord and grow into his likeness, God may sanctify the lives of all those with whom you have to do. So now, in order that we may know your mind and purpose, you must make, please, the declarations that we put to you. Do you accept the Holy Scriptures as revealing all things necessary for eternal salvation through faith in Jesus Christ? Will you be diligent in prayer, in reading Holy Scripture, and in all studies that will deepen your faith and fit you to bear witness to the truth of the gospel? Will you lead Christ's people in proclaiming his glorious gospel so that the good news of salvation may be heard in every place? Will you faithfully minister the doctrine and sacraments of Christ as the Church of England has received them, so that the people committed to your charge may be defended against error and flourish in the faith? Will you, knowing yourself to be reconciled to God in Christ, strive to be an instrument of God's peace in the church and in the world? Will you endeavor to fashion your own life and that of your household according to the way of Christ, that you may be a pattern, an example to Christ's people? Will you work with your fellow servants in the gospel for the sake of the kingdom of God? Will you accept and minister the discipline of this church and respect authority duly exercised within it? Will you then, in the strength of the Holy Spirit, continually stir up the gift of God that is in you to make Christ known among all whom you serve? As you're able, please stand. Sisters and brothers, you have heard how great is the charge that these ordinands are ready to undertake, and you have heard their declarations. Is it now your will that they should be ordained?
It is.
Will you continually pray for them?
We will.
And will you uphold and encourage them in their ministry?
We will.
In the name of our Lord, we bid you remember the greatness of the trust that is now to be committed to your charge. Remember always with thanksgiving that the treasure now to be entrusted to you is Christ's own flock, bought by the shedding of his blood on the cross. And it is to him that you will render account for your stewardship of his people. You cannot bear the weight of this calling in your own strength, but only by the grace and power of God. Pray, therefore, that your heart may daily be enlarged and your understanding of the Scriptures enlightened. Pray earnestly for the gift of the Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Ghost, our souls inspire and lighten with celestial fire. Thou the anointing Spirit art, who dost thy sevenfold gifts impart. Thy blessed unction from above is comfort, life, and fire of love. Enable with perpetual light the dullness of our blinded sight. Anoint and cheer our souls with the abundance of thy grace. Keep far our foes, give peace at home. Where thou art guide, no ill can come.
Teach us to know the Father, Son, and Thee of both to be but one, that through the ages all along this may be our endless song. Praise to Thy eternal merit, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For all the members of the Church in their vocation and ministry, that they may serve Him in truth and love, let us pray to the Lord. For our bishops, Stephen, Gavin, Alan, and Olivia, and for all bishops, presbyters, and deacons, that they may hunger for truth and thirst after righteousness, let us pray to the Lord. For James, Samson, Peter, Gareth, Ross, and Kate, called to be priests in his church, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness we may proclaim the gospel of reconciliation to the ends of the earth, let us pray to the Lord. For the unity of the Church, that we may be one in Christ according to his will, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for those who do not yet believe, that they may receive the light of the gospel, and for those whose faith has grown cold, let us pray to the Lord. For the sick and suffering, for the aged and infirm, for the lonely and neglected, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor and the hungry, for the homeless and the oppressed, for all prisoners and captives, and for our brothers and sisters who are persecuted for their faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Elizabeth, our Queen, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For ourselves, for grace to repent and amend our lives, that we may be pardoned and absolved from all our sins, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
remembering all who have gone before us in faith, and in communion with Frideswide, Barinus, and all the saints, we commit ourselves, one another, and our whole life to Christ our God.
We praise and glorify you, Almighty Father, because in your infinite love you have formed throughout the world a holy people for your own possession, a royal priesthood, a universal church. We praise and glorify you because you have given us your only Son, Jesus Christ, the image of your eternal and invisible glory, the firstborn of all creation and head of the church. We praise and glorify you that by his death he has overcome death, and that having ascended into heaven, he has given his gifts abundantly to equip your holy people for the work of ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ. And now we give you thanks that you have called your servants, whom we ordain in your name, to share as a priest in the ministry of the gospel of Christ, the apostle and high priest of our faith, and shepherd of our souls. Therefore, Father, through Christ our Lord, we pray. Send down the Holy Spirit on your servant James for the office and work of a priest in your church. James, may God, who anointed the Lord Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit at his baptism, anoint and empower you to reconcile and to bless his people. Send down your Holy Spirit upon your servant Samson for the office and work of a priest in your church. Samson, may God, who anointed the Lord Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit at his baptism, anoint and empower you to reconcile and to bless his people. Send down your Holy Spirit on your servant Peter for the office and work of a priest in your church. Peter, may God, who anointed the Lord Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit at his baptism, anoint and empower you to reconcile and to bless his people. Send down your Holy Spirit on your servant Gareth for the office and work of a priest in your church. Gareth, may God, who anointed the Lord Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit at his baptism, anoint and empower you to reconcile and to bless his people. Send down your Holy Spirit on your servant Ross for the office and work of a priest in your church. Ross. May God, who anointed the Lord Jesus Christ at his baptism with the Holy Spirit, anoint and empower you to reconcile and to bless his people. Send down your Holy Spirit on your servant Kate for the office and work of a priest in your church. Kate. May God, who anointed the Lord Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit at his baptism, anoint and empower you to reconcile and to bless his people. Through your Spirit, Heavenly Father, give to your servants grace and power to proclaim the gospel of salvation and minister the sacraments of the new covenant. Renew them in holiness and give them wisdom and discipline to work faithfully with those committed to their charge. In union with their fellow servants in Christ, may they reconcile what is divided, heal what is wounded, and restore what is lost. May they declare your blessings to your people. May they proclaim Christ's victory over the powers of darkness and absolve in Christ's name those who turn to him in faith. So shall a people made whole in Christ offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to you, our God and Father, to whom, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, belong glory and honor, worship and praise, now and forever. Amen. James, receive this book. Samson, receive this book. Peter, receive this book. Gareth, receive this book. Ross, receive this book. Kate, receive this book. As a sign of the authority which God has given you this day to preach the gospel of Christ and to minister his holy sacraments.
God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. We welcome you as an ambassador for Christ. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly.
God has made us one in Christ. He has set his seal upon us, and as the pledge of all that is to come, has given us the Spirit to dwell in our hearts. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Just offer one another an acknowledgement, a sign of peace. Peace. Peace be with you. Thanks. Wow. Brilliant. That's Gareth sorted.
Forth in glorious day, up from the grave. grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me.
Pour upon the poverty of our love and the weakness of our praise the transforming fire of your presence. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and good, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks and praise through your servant, Jesus Christ our Lord. At his baptism, he was revealed as your beloved Son, coming among us as one who serves. He taught us that the greatest in your kingdom are those who make themselves least and the servants of all. Although he was their teacher and their Lord, he washed the feet of his disciples and commanded us to do the same, that we might reveal the power of your love made perfect in our human weakness. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes, and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favor on your people, gather us in your loving arms, and bring us with Frideswide, Berinus, all your saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, O loving Father, forever and ever. Amen. As our Savior taught us, so we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share the one bread. God's holy gifts for God's holy people. Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father, the body and blood of Christ.
let us pray. Holy and blessed God, you have fed us with the body and blood of your Son and filled us with your Holy Spirit. May we honor you not only with our lips, but in lives dedicated to your service. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. God, who has called you, is faithful. May the Father, whose glory fills the heavens, cleanse you by his holiness and send you out to proclaim his word. Amen. May Christ, who has ascended to the heights, pour upon you the riches of his grace. May the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, equip you and strengthen you in your ministry. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Can you do